We go to the Williams Tractor Hotline right now. Visiting with a former Razorback, a three-time Gold Glove winner with the St. Louis Cardinals, member of the Missouri Sports Hall of Fame, All-Star in 1992, Tom Pagnozzi is our guest here on Ruskin and Zach. Good afternoon, Tom. How are you?
Real good, guys. Doing good.
Appreciate you spending some time with us today. We got a lot of different things we want to discuss. Of course, the first thing that came to our mind was watching this 1998 documentary a few days ago about McGuire and Sosa and the chase. You were there for a lot of that. Did you see that, and did that bring any recollections or stories up for you?
Yeah, without a doubt. You know, it was a crazy summer. To replay that, it's been a long time. And it's something that people always ask about, you know, what was it like? And I made a comment about in the middle of it. I said, I guess this was like what the Beatles went through. It's like watching the Beatles when they came to America. I mean, that's what it was like watching McGuire put on a show.
Tom, I'm curious. I mean, the Cubs are in your division. And that thing took off in mid to late May and then into June. And then all of a sudden it became a home run race between both McGuire and Sosa. You talk about it being like the Beatles when they come to America. It had to go into overdrive when the Cardinals came in or you're up in Wrigley. I mean, it had to be insane around the batting cage before a game.
Well, the players couldn't get around the batting cage. It was all media. I mean, it was crazy. McGuire got off to a big jump. I mean, I think at one point he was like 12 or 15 home runs ahead real early, and then Sammy climbed into it, and then it became a race. Without a doubt, when those two clubs played, it was unbelievable. I mean, the game was secondary. BP was first. The game was secondary. It was impressive. I remember in 96 when we got McGuire, I was, the pitchers and catchers always do a meeting during the last group of BP. And, usually the way the BP works, 1 through 4 hitters were in the last group. 5 through 8 were in the second, which was my group. I would go in and we'd have pitcher-catcher meeting. And the first day, David Bell came in and goes, God dang, you should see this display. So, I went to Dave Duncan and said, hey, is there any way we could have our meeting before or after BP? And he goes, why? I said, because David Bell told me that McGuire hit 20 balls in the upper deck. I mean, I've seen like 3 balls go in the upper deck in all those times at that stadium. And so he goes, sure. We all went out there and it was like, holy smokes, And then, it just went crazy.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
98 was just, it was unbelievable. And like we said, when both teams played together, it was secondary, people crawling over. It was electric, I've been to championship fights. It was like that, The stands are buzzing. Everybody remembers where they were standing when McGuire was taking BP. I stood right here during BP, And it's funny because, the people in the outfield at Wrigley, that they hang out there to get baseballs during BP. Not when McGuire came up. They were outside the park going off the building.
Right. Wow. Had to be out in the street. That's right.
Yeah.
We're talking with Tom Pagnozzi here on Ruskin and Zach. So, McGuire, where does he rank up in terms of guys you played with as a hitter? Where does he stack up?
Well, what he was unbelievable. What people don't realize is how good of a hitter he was, how disciplined he was. I mean, yes, he struck out a lot, but what you don't realize, they always talk about, man, good hitters, they don't strike out a whole lot, or their walks to hit ratio. Power guys, usually their strikeout to strikeout to walk ratio is, one walk to 4 strikeouts. McGuire, I mean, that year he walked over 160 times.
Wow, that's great plate discipline.
That's a lot. That's one a game.
Yeah.
They didn't want to pitch to him, and to be disciplined. I do remember he had more extra base hits than, he had 70 home runs, obviously, and I don't know, it was 20 or 30 doubles, and like 45 singles. I mean, it was a double home run or go home,
I want to ask you, very infamously, when Roger Maris was chasing the home run record, he went through some physical ailments. The stress really got to him. I can't imagine what it was like in 1998 or if a player had to go through it today, where, you know, today in social media, it would be crushing. Yeah. But you had a front row seat for how this affected him behind the scenes. BP is one thing when he's out there just, you know, hitting the ball. But when he's in the locker room, did he change as the season went on?
Well, yes, you could see it. There was days where he blew up and you know, blow up on non-baseball stuff. Because one, people want to get into your personal stuff. And McGuire was very, very private. So if you tried to get into that, it was going to be trouble. And I remember one night, you know, a reporter asked him, you know, something, and he just snapped, you know, I mean, it's unfortunate. You know, he couldn't go anywhere. He couldn't breathe without someone else wanting some of that air. I mean, it was unbelievable. You felt for him. But on the flip side, you know, we were picked to win the division that year, and we finished 500 or like two or three games above 500. We weren't very good, you know, and nobody was talking about, thank God, because what he was doing, you know, it took the pressure off us. It was easy for us to go play and watch. You know, you played, then you became a fan when he was up. You didn't miss an at-bat when he came up to play. But yes, you could see the stress, and the longer it went, the more draining it was, because, you know, he tries to be cordial, you know, but when, you know, 50 new newspapers are there a day or magazines and want to do interviews and try to get a question, you know, he would stand in his locker room and he would ask. And the thing is, you know, as an athlete, when you're doing interviews, when the same question's asked four times, you get tired of it.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's when he would say, I've already answered that question. I mean, you know, if they just want a different version because they asked it. I don't know. You know, it's crazy sometimes. But you definitely saw the stress on it, without a doubt.
Yeah.
But that would be anybody.
Sure.
It's like watching the Jordan 30 for 30, you know. Just, you know, same thing. It was like that.
Yeah. We're talking with Tom Pagnozzi here on Ruskin and Zach. I also wanted to get your thoughts on it seems like the two sides on the current situation are like 10 games apart now on getting baseball started in 2020. What if you had a say in any of these meetings right now, how would you bring things together so we could see baseball in this summer?
You know, I sat in that room. I was our player rep for about 6 years. I've been there. I was involved in, you know, the cancellation of the World Series. It's a tough situation. It goes beyond what the players are talking about. They're concerned about their health, about what happens if I get it, and you guys are leaving Cincinnati to fly to New York, and I can't get on that plane, and I got to go back to the hotel. There's more to the moving parts. It's sad that they you know, again, we always talk about millionaires and billionaires fighting. It's never good. Nobody ever wins when it's like that. And especially today, with everything that's going on, people out of work and unemployment at what it is, again, you know, you don't want to see it. You know, we need them to get back to playing. But I also feel on their part, these guys have short careers. Health is very, very important. And they're concerned. And they want answers that they're not getting, because there is, you know, they thought there was going to be testing at that time that was going to be instantaneously. It's not here yet, you know. It's not at that level. So you know, there's still concerns, but you just hope that they can figure it out. You know, the NBA said a long time ago they were playing hockey. None of those camps have opened up yet, because it's the same issue now. They've worked out their dollars. They've worked out their agreements. But the things about, you know, catching it and the travel and all that is not here yet. And, you know, the NBA, how long ago did they say they were playing? It was 3 or 4 weeks ago. Camps haven't even opened up yet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, but we're talking about baseball. Those same things are going to happen.
You're the perfect person to ask this, since you've been in those meetings. I mean, we see the public statements from Manfred and Tony Clark. How much of what they are putting out publicly is posturing versus what those real discussions are like? It just seems like they've drawn a line in the sand and there's no commonality between them.
Well, because they're stuck on other issues. But it's about 50-50. You know, both sides try to produce stuff to make one side look bad. Really, you know, the best thing is to put a stop to the talk. Let's get in a room and finish it. The problem is they can't get in a room. It's all done by Zoom and stuff like that. Before, you know, I remember sitting in a room, the negotiating committee, I mean, 18 hours without leaving. Nobody's leaving until we get a deal done. You know, that we are close to it, and that's how the deal got, because negotiators are, you know, in separate rooms, we meet, go back to separate rooms, meet, back to separate rooms. You got it done, but right now, there's too much information out with social, and you got players tweeting, owners tweeting. You know, it's unfortunate it can't be done privately and in face-to-face and get it done, because if they could negotiate like it was back in the days, you know, I think they would be done now, but they're not. It's easy to click off the Zoom and say, end the meeting, you know,
yeah.
And everybody go their separate ways, where before it was, we're not leaving this hotel until we have an answer, you know, until we both figure it out.
And I think you bring up a lot of excellent points there, but one that you talked about earlier is, say someone gets it and you're out for 2 weeks at least. Well, that could be 14 games in a shortened season. That's a lot of time missed when certain guys may have different you know, things in their contract about stats and numbers and that sort of thing.
Well, the one thing in baseball, you know, there's only a few stats you can put in there. I mean, a few award bonuses, All-Star, Gold Glove, MVP, Cy Young, games played.
Okay.
That's the only ones you can't have, averages. You can't have any of those. Well, none of those are going to be attained on the games played. I mean, because nobody gets a 40-game bonus. You know, it's right. Usually at 100 and, you know, more. So those are out the door. Baseball has always been that way, so that, you know, because there's so much strategy in baseball, you know, if I had so many hits and he gave me the bunt sign, I'm missing that sign because I need hits, you know.
So true.
They've taken that out, you know. From that standpoint. So, I mean, it's still a long way. In my opinion, they're still a long ways away. I mean, I think the posturing is more on the player side because they want answers if I get sick. I mean, the scenario that I was talking with one of my buddies in St. Louis, you know, we used, you know, Wainwright as an example. He comes in Sunday night, you know, Sunday day game in Cincinnati and has a temperature, you know, and the team's flying to Philadelphia. What do? Send Wainwright back to the hotel? The hotel's not going to want him. But the charter flight's going to Philly. You don't want to put him on a charter flight. It's things like that they've got to figure out.
Wow. Yeah. I mean, you're bringing up some points that, I mean, are deep level points on both sides. I want to ask you, I mean, you were there in 94 when the season, you know, was cut short. I'm curious, what was sort of the reaction when you guys came back in 95? I mean, sitting here on June 19th, it feels like, to me, a baseball fan, that we're not going to have baseball in 2020. And that means we're going to restart in 21. From a player's perspective, what was that spring and then subsequent summer like in 95 when you guys came back?
Well, you know, it's funny. It's always recovered afterwards. It took 3 years to get back to the attendance levels that we were at. You know, we had each year up to that point, we were breaking records attendance of overall in baseball. You know, St. Louis is a little bit different, you know, and I played my whole career there. The greatest fans, they come. Yeah, they came and let us know that they weren't happy with it. But after a few weeks, that all died down, and we got back to playing baseball. It has always been like that. I don't know if this time, if they can't figure it out, I think there's going to be a lot of changes in a lot of avenues and a lot of things, you know, going forward from here. You know, that's an answer that's a tough one. Where does baseball go? You know, at that time it was number one. Football's overtaken that. You know, basketball's on the verge of coming back. You know, but you know, where does baseball slide in? You know, there's people talking about hockey's going to become the next thing. I don't know. I don't think hockey ever will be. But you know, it's going to take some time, without a doubt. Especially if it's canceled over games or dollars or something like that.
Tom Pagnozzi is our guest here on Ruskin and Zach. Before we let you go here, Tom, I got to ask you about what we've seen, particularly in the last 4, 5, 6 years with the Arkansas program, you know, a couple of runs at a national championship, new facility going up with the new facility with locker rooms and everything. Just what does it mean to you to see this program thriving under Dave Van Horn?
Oh, it's awesome. I mean, you know, you always want the school that you went to be, you know, relevant. I mean, we are now a baseball school. I mean, you could go out to Arizona, California, and you're talking about Arkansas baseball. I mean, nationally, it's a great conference. And I'm telling you, college baseball is about to get even better and more fun. If they move the start date to March 15th versus February 15th, it's a difference of about 15 degrees where you're going to come into the game instead of freezing. It's going to be enjoyable. It's going to go later. The Major League Draft, they're cutting minor league teams. So a lot of kids that sign that are not really prospects, they're fillers in the minor leagues, they're going to go to college. It's going to make the whole college game better. And think about being here in Fayetteville, Arkansas. You know, really the playoffs start, you know, early June. It's, you know, regionals are overdone by the second week. We wouldn't be starting until right at about the 1st of July. So every night you're going to be playing night games at Baum Stadium 3-4 nights a week in you know, the month of June, the month of July, you know, part of July. It's going to be a lot of fun. I hope it happens. Dave's done a tremendous job on the national level.
Absolutely. Well, Tom Pagnozzi, our guest here on Ruskin and Zach. Thanks so much for the time, Tom. We really appreciate it.
You bet, guys. Anytime.
All right, Tom and all our guests join us on the Williams Tractor Hotline here on Ruskin and Zach.
A lot of great stuff in there.
Yeah,
a lot of great stuff.
They really they got to move this calendar back. It just, when you're out there and it's 35 degrees at a baseball game in February when it's, you know, Kent State and Arkansas. I mean, what are we doing here? Come on. March 15th, you get a crowd there. I mean, come on, it's totally different.
Yeah, it's only 45.
That's right.
Well, 45 with a 28-mile-an-hour wind.
You might be in the 50s by March 15th.
With a 28-mile-an-hour wind.
That's right. Something like that.